Dead, Notes from the Underground, the new album. Hollywood Undead, Notes from the Underground, available now.
Hello, everybody. A for Awesome here. I am really sorry for the lack of uploads, the lack of just general things have been very wonky the last few years. I mean, I'm not going to go into a giant update video. I've talked about it in detail several times. But the point is, it's probably going to stay a little wonky, but I know it's been almost about two years since I did the Deuce 9 Lives review, and I wanted to do the next part a long, long time ago, like I really did. But life has just been really hard, and I'm just now finding the time after almost, I think we're almost on to 3 years now, that I'm now able to sit down and actually get this video done. So yeah, we are reviewing Hollywood Undead's Notes from the Underground. And, you know, before I go into the backstory of the making of the album and everything going on, this album marks the start of an era and the end of one at the same time. It really marks the end of the sound that Hollywood Undead had started with all the way back in 2005. I really don't think they ever sounded quite the same after this album. But it also marked the personal start of when I got into Hollywood Undead. Was this album came out, and I wasn't really big into music at the time. There was a couple things I listened to. I listened to a lot of like EDM, and then Korn Path of Totality came out a few years prior. I really enjoyed that. I'd heard a couple Hollywood Undead songs, but nothing really specific. I think I'd heard Young and Hear Me Now, and that was like the only two, and I didn't know who they were. Oh, and I heard Undead on the UFC game that it was on. So I wasn't like deep into them. And then Notes from the Underground came out, and that's when I listened to We Are on repeat. I had burned CDs with just a bunch of songs I liked, and I wish I still had them, but like I released an album called Austin Taylor's, like Austin's Album of Awesomeness is I guess the best, and that's literally the name of the burned CD that I had as a kid, was just Austin's Album of Awesomeness, and it was like 25 tracks of just a bunch of different songs, none of them fitting. Like there was Korn, there was We Are, there was just a bunch of crap. I think it was probably more than 25. I remember there was like some Five Nights at Freddy's fan songs on there. There was Gangnam Style. There was like basically, yeah, like it was insane. And I think We Are to this day is still, I think Hollywood Undead genuinely, as much as Swan Songs is my personal favorite album, I think they hit their peak in terms of just all around as a band was with this album. I think that they really got taken seriously in terms of like you'll kind of hear the information of how this was definitely their most popular cycle. And kind of looking when I did the research for this review and rewriting this script after like 6 years since it's been originally written, realizing the downfall that they took into almost obscurity to the point where a lot of people don't even remember them really sucks, knowing this, you know, this was such a highlight of their career, and that they were everywhere. I mean, they're still relatively big in like Russia and Germany and Europe in general, but they were huge from American Tragedy until like they were getting big with Swan Songs. Like, they definitely had a big fan base, but that was mostly like American Tragedy, and this album really cemented them as actually like a big band that was like in Canada, lots of people knew them, America, everywhere. They were known. They were a well-known band. And then after this album released, they really dropped off. And now at this point, I think they still tour, but they're really the most crowds they get are usually in like Russia and like Germany and those kind of areas. So yeah, but anyway, A little bit of background information, I guess, that wasn't really included in this script when I wrote it, and it's something that I've just kind of had to research more into. During the writing recording process of Swan Songs and American Tragedy, during the recording of Swan Songs, Johnny Three Tears' daughter was born, as well as he was starting to develop a drinking problem. Well, too, like, he already drank a lot prior to being big, but it got worse. And during the early days of the band, J-Dog and Deuce were best friends. Over time, this has been confirmed by multiple sources, Deuce and Johnny became closer friends than Deuce and J-Dog did, and that really formed a rift between the three of them, where J-Dog started to feel a little bit, not out of the loop per se, but J-Dog wasn't as close of a band member to, you know, there's many songs on Swan Songs that's, you know, like you've got Young, The Diary, Paradise Lost, I think there's one other that's just Johnny and Deuce, because they were writing a lot of stuff together, and J-Dog kind of felt sidelined during that process, because even though he was one of the founding members, he didn't get a lot. Like, he got a verse on Undead, he got a pre-chorus on Sell Your Soul, he got the bridge on City, and I think he got one other verse. Oh, he got a verse on California, and that's it. That's all he got on that album. Oh, and Black Dahlia. But, like, he was very much sidelined while Johnny and Deuce and Charlie, to a lesser extent, took full front seat. And it's Charlie's became even more of a mainstay, but if you look at Swan Songs, it was very heavily Deuce and Johnny on that album. And after the rift kind of caused whatever happened with Deuce and Johnny, there's multiple sides. Nobody's confirmed or denied 100%. It's a very messy situation, but Deuce saying that he was kicked out by the band, them saying that he quit, and Johnny specifically not really wanting to talk about it just due to him being friends with everybody. Johnny's alcoholism continued to spiral during the writing process and recording and everything for American Tragedy. And unfortunately, that led to this album where he began to use cocaine, and he also began to have struggles with his vocals. And unfortunately, from this era on, his vocals really dropped off in quality. They're starting to come back, but for the longest time, he couldn't really reach what he used to be able to do. And that's a really unfortunate fact about being in the music industry, is that, But following the extensive touring throughout 2011 to promote their second studio album, American Tragedy, and their first remix album, American Tragedy Redux, Charlie Sheen announced plans to begin a third studio album in late November of 2011. And during the interview, Charlie Sheen even mentioned hoping to have some guest rappers on the album. That never ended up happening, but it was something. It is rumored that there were a few different bands that did come into the studio and make some collab songs that were just never released. The announcement of the album came after the conclusion of the band's World War III tour with Asking Alexandria, which is one of the bands that was rumored to have been guest appearing on the new album. Charlie Sheen stated that the band will begin writing and recording demos while on the Buried Alive tour with Avenged Sevenfold, and begin recording once the tour concludes in December 2011. Avenged Sevenfold was never actually rumored to be on the album, though. He also stated the album will sound more similar to Swan Songs than America Tragedy had sounded. Commenting on the difference in recording this time around, he stated, "I would say that this time the label gave us full creative control. I think it's going to be more like Swan Songs than American Tragedy. I mean, it'll obviously be a mixture of both. We have different members, and we all grow as artists, we get older, and I think we've been doing it enough for long enough that I think we can go back to that sound while still keeping it sounding fresh. I think the fans will like it a lot." Artist Direct named the band's upcoming album as one of the most anticipated albums of 2012, along with Living Things by Linkin Park, Death Magnetic by Metallica, 13 by Black Sabbath, and others. The band also revealed that Griffin Boyce
and Danny Lohner, who worked with the band on their previous albums, have returned to produce the upcoming third album. They also revealed that they will be upgrading their masks again like they did prior to the release of their second album, American Tragedy. During 2012, the band was scheduled to play in a series of music festivals, including Epic Ender 2012, Summerfest, Aftershock, Rockfest, and others, joining bands such as Stone Temple Pilots, Escape the Fate, Deftones, and more. I believe Escape the Fate was actually rumored to have been on the album as well, but it never happened, so... On October 19th, they released the track Dead Bite from the album for a free download, along with a lyric video to it and announcement of the album's upcoming first single. On October 29th, the lead single We Are was released, along with the album title being revealed to be Notes from the Underground. In a new interview with J-Dog and DeCurls on a podcast, they explained how the new album reminds them of the roots of Hollywood Undead, how when they first started recording, how much fun they had doing without the label telling them what to do. They both explained that this album would sound more like Swan Songs than American Tragedy. They also revealed that the album would be released on January 8th, 2013. On December 11th, the band announced that they will embark on a headlining tour titled The Underground Tour to promote Notes from the Underground. The tour dates ranged from January 8th, 2013 to January 23rd, starting in Hollywood, California. A video was released in promotion of the upcoming tour. And that's another thing that makes me sad, is they haven't done a headlining tour in a long time. They've always just been support. Like, I saw them live 3 times, and every time they were one of the openers, or they were one of the supports. On October 29th, 2012, the first official single from Notes from the Underground, titled We Are, was released on iTunes, along with a lyric video on the band's official YouTube channel. The song reached number 33 on the Top Rock Songs chart. Johnny Three Tears commented on the song, saying, "The song is about collective resistance. It's the silent majority, but we're using Los Angeles as the backdrop. Every time we work with Danny Lohner, he takes our music to the next level. Think of it as an ode to our misled youth." A lot of people have viewed it as a sequel to Young at the time. At the time, it was viewed as a continuation of the story begun in the song Young. A music video was released for We Are on December 11th, which was directed by Slipknot member Clown. DeCurls commented on their work with Clown, saying, "We are very excited to be working with someone that thinks about their art the same way that we do. Clown is a great director, and together we are going to deliver something truly memorable." USA Today described We Are as the horror-loving rap-rock outfit Hollywood Undead previews January's Notes from the Underground with We Are, an anthem for the youth. A brutally captivating chorus wraps desolation and desperation into the lyrics, "We are made from broken parts, we are broken from the start." It's self-destructive and cathartic. The third single and third song off Notes from the Underground, Another Way Out, was the official theme song for WWE's pay-per-view event on June 16th, 2013. The music video for Dead Bite was released on August 20th, 2013. Much of the music on the album remains rooted in the hip-hop sound that began with Swan Songs and really does sound like a good mix of the two albums.
There's no argument over the choice between peace and war. This boy, a young mechanic, can be a panic. With just a good looking pants.
Put your fucking hands up!
Track 1, Dead Bite. Dead Bite is a rap-style song that is meant to fit with the overall theme of Notes from the Underground, which is that the entire album is kind of meant to have this creepy circus sound and... Well, not necessarily circus, but yes, it has this creepy horror tone to it that even the party songs follow, and the masks and the whole vibe. This song was
not as good as the as Undead. I would say it was a better opening track than Been to Hell. I do like Been to Hell, but I think that this track really opened the album in a exciting way, which Been to Hell did, but in a different way. That it sets the tone for the album that it is going to have a similar feel to Swan Songs. It has a very similar sound. However, I feel as though this track was definitely inferior to Undead. However, in recent years, this track, because this track was removed from set lists after, I believe it was removed after Day of the Dead or 5 came out. Like, it was removed a couple years down the line, but it's recently been brought back and has now become a mainstay, interestingly enough. Track 2, From the Ground. A song that reminds me a lot of Sell Your Soul, with the guitars, piano, sung chorus, and J-Dog doing a lot of the heavy lifting on this part. I think that this song is very much a spiritual successor to what they were doing with Sell Your Soul. I don't think it quite reaches the same highs that Sell Your Soul did. However, I think it comes closer to doing that than Dead By ever did for Undead. I think there are times where this really does feel like this is the same band, which I feel like American Tragedy really didn't do. I enjoy American Tragedy. It's still one of my favorite albums of all time. But going right from, like, not including deluxe editions, going right from Paradise Lost to Been to Hell, it really feels like a whole different group of people made that album. It's very tame compared to what was being done before. Track 3, Another Way Out. This song fits with the theme of the creepy kind of circus sound. I am not a lot of people really enjoy this song, but I'm not really much of a fan of it due to it's really short and it's been overplayed and overdone in, like, creepy music videos. And I think the worst part is looking into the lyrics, there's a lot of it's meant to be about, like, I don't think, like, this is the leading reason. Not a lot of songs are explained by Hollywood Undead, but it is considered very much so to be a song about surviving sexual assault. And I don't think the sound really works. And I don't think that subject matter really works for Hollywood Undead as a band in general, just due to the fact that, you know, half the songs on their first three albums, actually their first four albums, are specifically about, like, partying, and there's lines in their earlier songs where they're talking about, like, underage girls. And so I don't think a song that acts as though it respects what people have gone through is a good, you can't really do both. It especially not with the playful sound that they go for. It almost feels like they're mocking them. So I've never been a fan of this song. I think, yeah. Track 4, Lion. I wrote in the original script, because I have it up and I'm looking at it, that this was the creepypasta character Smile Dog's theme song. Yes, I wrote this script so long. I think I was like 14 when I wrote the script to this review. And that's why I had to go and rewrite it and change it. I think that when I said that, it was supposed to be a joke, because there were so many people who would post that song with, like, pictures of a Smile Dog. I think the song is very well written. I think it's grown on, like, I've always enjoyed Lion as a song. I think it's really grown on me over the years, for sure. Like, it's still been on regular rotation since I first heard it, but it's got a new meaning after, you know, everything. And knowing the lives of the members of the band, and obviously this is just a Johnny Three Tears and Danny song, but I think a lot of the kind of implications of this song seem to point, it seems to be about Johnny feeling as though he has failed as a parent, as a friend, as a son, as everything. And that he wants to do better, and he doesn't know how he can. And that's my personal interpretation. So, yeah. Track 5, We Are. The song is sung by several members of the band, and the music video was directed by Clown from Slipknot. Danny is singing the chorus, Johnny Three Tears is rapping the first verse, J-Dog is rapping the second verse, and the bridge is screamed by J-Dog and DeCurls, and Danny doing a rare, not necessarily a scream, but more hard vocals than he usually does. And that definitely remind me of his early Lorene Drive days. Don't get used to that, though. He very rarely will ever go back to that. In fact, he's releasing solo work right now that sounds less like punk and sounds less like Lorene Drive and more like The Weeknd. The song is often put next to the swan song single Young by fans, as it has similar vibes and the message is the same. Lyrics to the song were inspired by a book known as America's Youth, quoted by Johnny Three Tears as he continues, "I feel full-on empathy for what kids are going to have to go through because it doesn't seem to be getting any better. In fact, it seems quite the opposite. It's pretty sickening what these kids have to see on a regular basis." Track 6, Pigskin. Pigskin is... Look, I don't hate any Hollywood Undead song. Even the most cringy ones like Turn Off the Lights, I can find some enjoyment of. Like, that one has a nice bass line, I've said before. But I think this is the weakest point of the album, personally. I think even for the party tracks that Hollywood Undead have released, I think that this is the weakest of those in general. I think even the new party tracks that they've released as 40-year-old men have better lyrics and are better written and more interesting to listen to than this song. This song to me sounds less like something Hollywood Undead would put out and more like something that Pitbull and Justin Bieber would work on together. And that's really not something I want to hear when I'm listening to a Hollywood Undead album. There's, you know, the title and everything. It's all football references. But putting this only two tracks, it's only about 2.5 minutes, and putting this only three tracks after a song that's supposed to be about sexual assault with the same people rapping the verses, the same person singing, and talking about wearing people out like Nikes, and I think that they needed to take out one of these songs. There needed to be a one or the other in this scenario. And if I had to pick, I don't like either of these songs in particular. I think they both don't really suit this band. But I think Another Way Out was a lot more successful than this song. I think it would have been better if they left Another Way Out and then maybe did another song in that same style, where even though I wasn't a fan of what felt like a song mocking survivors of that, maybe doing a more serious ballad in replace of this song that actually seems to follow up on that. Maybe, you know, have that song have been through the eyes of the objectifier and have this song have been, instead of this, do a... It's kind of a song like Rain or something that's more of a, or even Bullet, that's about kind of like an acoustic slow song moving on from trauma. But yeah, I'm not a fan of this song. I think the best way, if they had to work with the track list they have now, switching this song and track 7 out would have worked a lot better, I think, because moving on to track 7, Rain. I still enjoy this song. Even when other Hollywood Undead songs have gotten old, which they don't get old often for me, there's a few that I've been like, okay, I don't really care for this song anymore. But I think this is a song that still to this day hits me with the same emotional feelings, and I think it would have worked better if it came... I think the only thing I dislike is its placement in the album. On its own, it's an amazing song. I would even go as far as to call it an actual, like, masterpiece. Like, I would say that there are songs by Metallica that I like less than this. I reviewed Led Zeppelin's albums. I would listen to this more than certain quite a few different Led Zeppelin songs. Yes, technically it's not a masterpiece. It's nothing special. It isn't like... I'm not praising the guitar work on this. I'm just saying that personally, I enjoy it myself. Personally, it is something that I get a good feel. It hits me in the feelings more than a lot of classic rock ballads do, as bad as that is.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
I think the only thing I dislike is its general placement in the Notes from the Underground track list. I think if you moved it up by one, then this would have worked better. I think putting Pigskin as track 7 and putting this as track 6 would have worked a lot well. You would have had the high energy We Are go into the slow melodic rain and then come out into Pigskin and then go into Kill Everyone. I think that would have flowed a lot better. I think that would have kept the high energy going. I think listening to the album from, you know, track 1 to the end of it, this song really, you know, they hype you up, they get you in the mood going through, even Lion, even though it's a ballad, still has that energy to it. And then it just stops. And as much as, like I said, I enjoy this song, I actually play it anytime it rains. It's just one of my favorite songs in the world. Like, it's got to be in my top 100 songs, at least top 100. But it really pauses the whole album and kills the vibe. And I think if you had moved it up to be right after We Are, it would have killed the vibe in a better way. It would have really continued that cathartic, like, feeling that you get with We Are. And then you would have been able to go into having some more fun. But overall, lyrically, it's great. Musically, it's great. I enjoy it. And I think, despite the fact that I would have personally moved it up, that it is still a great song, and I'm sure there's a reason they put it where they did in the album. And, you know, if you're just listening mindlessly, you're not going to care. I think if you're really getting into the album, though, as a track list as a whole, that this doesn't really work where it is. But it's still a great song to me. And I could never bring myself to say that I dislike this song, because, as I said, it's probably in my top favorites of all time. Track 8. Kill Everyone. Okay, so I wrote in the original script that Kill Everyone is me when I'm at an elementary school, and I just want to say that that's really bad, but that's still kind of a hilarious joke. That's so edgy, but I kind of love it. But, I mean, there's not much to say about this song. I think I know a lot of people who, like, this is their favorite Hollywood Undead song. It used to be one of my favorites. I think it really kills the vibe after Rain. I think... Like I said, with Rain's placement on the album, it kills that vibe and makes it go slow. So then every time I've listened to the album from front to back, after ending Rain and having that melancholy, just to hear, "You've got the motherfucking right to remain," it always gets me laughing a little bit. And I feel like that wasn't the intention. I very much feel like it was supposed to be like a badass Charlie and Danny song, like Don't Fuck With Us, almost in the vein of like Dead in Ditches or something. But the way that it hit right after Rain, just, it does not work in that way. And it's all I can think about when I listen to the song is, did they purposely place this after Rain to get a laugh? Is this supposed to be an ironic song? Like, you know, they're trying to hit all these super high notes in the middle of talking about how badass they are. I'm sorry, but this song has, you know, when it definitely has hit that line of edginess. And I think it went over that and it jumped the shark a bit with... I think it would have been a lot easier to stomach if it came after Pigskin, and then Rain either came after this or came before Pigskin. Like, that's kind of, I think if Rain came after this, it would have killed the vibe too much, because you would have had this, and then you would have had gone right into the slow ballad of Believe. And I feel as though that would have been a little too much of the sad, sappy stuff, and it would have brought, it would bring you out of the album. I think putting Rain before Pigskin would have worked a lot better, just artistically. But this song is ruined by the fact that it's both preceded and followed by an emotional ballad. And this song is only about 2.5 minutes. So if you're listening from front to back, you're just with the album on, you're getting, you're nice and sad, and then you're getting hit with this just absolute cringe fest of edginess. And it's, like I said, it's not like it's a bad song. I can't bring myself to dislike it, but it's at the point where it is a song that is a so bad it's good kind of song that I can't bring myself to say that it's good in any way. But like, the lyrics are cringe. Everything about it is very much that early 2010s edgy, like Shadow the Hedgehog. Like, that's what I think of when I hear this song, is like Shadow the Hedgehog, Jeff the Killer, Ben Drowned, like Sonic EXE. Like, I think of like the most edgy early 2010 kind of shit that I can think of. But it is something that is a guilty pleasure song of mine, so I can't say that I dislike it. But like, you could never, if you looked at me and said that this song was anything more than a Break Stuff ripoff, I would laugh in your face, because it very much feels like it wants to be Limp Bizkit. And nobody should want to be Limp Bizkit, because Limp Bizkit is not very good. Track 9, Believe. I actually think that this could be one of the best Hollywood Undead songs ever, or at least one of the best ballads that they've ever done. I do enjoy this. I think J-Dog's verse is my favorite part. It's always nice to see Danny doing a verse. He doesn't do those very often, so that's definitely giving, both of those things give points to me. Johnny's verse is the only part that I wouldn't say drags. It's still really interesting to listen to. I just think after a really good verse from Danny, and then you get Johnny, and then you go into J-Dog, I find myself listening, just waiting for the J-Dog verse while Johnny is on. And that's maybe just a me thing. I think Johnny has a habit of, even though he's a brilliant songwriter, and I love his solo work, I love everything he's done, he has a habit of putting slang into things that really don't need it, or putting things that don't really make sense together. I don't really know if there's any other way to describe it, but like, he'll have these run-on sentences, or he will, it, like in Dead Bite, there's the cutoff in the middle of his verse because he ran on too long and they had to literally cut it and then add and then like fast forward. There's a couple, and it's mostly in this album. Like, it's not really even present in any of the other albums. It's only this album where you could hear him having to cut and take breaths. You can hear him running on. He really was not in the right headspace to be writing and recording an album at that time, unfortunately. Day of the Dead, it doesn't necessarily get worse. His vocals definitely get worse, but I think he was coked up enough, unfortunately, that he was going on harder than he needed to for things. And he really, I think because of the extensive touring that was going on both before, during, and after, he just could not do it. He needed to take the time off, unfortunately. So it's just something that I noticed, that this is a thing that has really come to bother me in most of the songs with heavily featuring Johnny from this album. I think Lion is the only one where he really hits the same way he did on Swan Songs. And I think that there's a couple other ones he actually does really good on. I think Outside he does really well on as well. Actually, Lion and Outside are his two highlights from this album. I think this verse, while it is good and well written, is just not a highlight of this song. And therefore, it kind of makes the song drone on until you get to the next part. Track Track 10, Up in Smoke. This is my favorite party song they've done other than Everywhere I Go. This is actually one of my favorite songs to get high to. The original script doesn't say this because I never smoked weed at that time. It just says that this is one of the few party songs by Hollywood Undead that I genuinely think is fire. But I do genuinely think it is one of their best songs. And it's interesting having like J-Dog rap on it and having a lot. It's very much has that same spirit. I really like the chorus, which feels like a mix of like almost, I think it's, I'm pretty sure it's Danny, Charlie, Funny, and DeKurls all in the chorus at once. I think the only member that doesn't get like an audible feature, I mean, DeKurls is always very, very quiet, but like, he does most of the vocal, like, background stuff. I think the only person who didn't really participate vocally on this song was Johnny. But yeah. Track 11. This is Outside. This is, I think, one of the highlights of the album. I still enjoy Lion more, just personally, but I can't deny that this is a really beautiful song, and I do really enjoy it in and of itself. It definitely doesn't seem to mean much of anything. Like, there's a lot of lyrics that kind of, they just feel like somebody had written a couple lines on a piece of paper over the course of like a year or like a couple months, and we're like, oh, hey, these sound cool. Let's put them together. Which, you know, works, sometimes works and sometimes doesn't. So there you go. But I do think that this is still a really, well, really beautiful song. I think the chorus actually, like doing the research, I think the chorus is a reference to a Loreen Drive song, because in the song that Danny did with Loreen Drive, I'm the most terrific liar you've ever seen in your life, it's awful, that's literally the name of the song, the chorus is, can you please leave the door open, please don't leave me outside. And then in this song he says, someone left the door open, but they left me outside. Even though if the door's open, you could go inside. That's what I'm saying, though, is these lyrics that it's like, I'm sure it sounded cool when they were writing it, or when they were in the studio, but not once did they ever think, hey, wait, that doesn't make sense. You know, like, it'd be better if it was like, someone left the door open to let me inside. I feel like it would be more hopeful that way. And I think it would suit that and be an even better reference to that previous song. Yeah, I mean, tell me if you think that this is like trying to be a... I don't think it's trying to be a sequel to that song. I just think Danny probably wrote the chorus himself and was like, this would be funny if it was a reference to this song, whether it was consciously or not. Now we're on to bonus tracks. Track 12, Medicine. This was one of the first Hollywood Undead songs I heard outside of We Are and Take Me... Like, this is one of the first ones I sought out on my own. I remember I had already heard, like I said, Undead, Young, Hear Me Now, Dead Bite, We Are, and Take Me Home. So this was the first song by them that I sought out on my own because I had heard it was really good. A lot of people were telling me they enjoyed it, like people I knew online. So I searched it out to be like, is it any good? And yeah, it is really well done. It's kind of got a mix of different things. It's very much, it does have the sound of a party song, like some of the lyrics, specifically the bridge. Seem like they're trying to go in that party direction. It's a very conflicted song. It doesn't really sound like it knows what it wants to be, because it also has a country almost sound going for it, but then it also is clearly about being addicted to drugs. I think what they were kind of trying to go for, I mean, in my script I said Maskey from Marble Hornets as a joke, but I think what they were really trying to go for with this is a genuine, like, yeah, we party, we have fun, but at the end of the day we try to be moderate with it, or we're getting older, we can't keep doing this to ourselves. I think Johnny's verse is unfortunately, again, the not the highlight of this song. There's a lot of lines in this that he drops that do not make any sense, and I actually find his verse quite not good. Like, I genuinely sometimes try and skip it. I think this is the worst vocals he's done on any song on this album, at least. Like, at least with Believe, I enjoyed it. It just wasn't as good as some of his other stuff. I think this is genuinely one of the only times on this album where I can sit here and say, I don't care for this verse at all. But the rest of the song sounds great, and even though it's another short, like, 2.5-minute song, I still think it's worth a listen. I've played it on loop multiple times. I think it's absolutely worth the praise that it gets. And, yeah. Track 13, One More Bottle. Honestly, I think this is, as bad as it sounds, I think this is my least favorite Hollywood Undead song ever made. And that's coming from somebody who finds the good in every Hollywood Undead song. Like I said, like, Turn Off the Lights is a disaster, but at least it has a nice bass line. Scene for Dummies is not a great song, but at least it has that really interesting DeKroll's intro and a really interesting chorus. Like, there's all those different things. So I think the fact that I can't really find a positive in this song at all, I think the lyrics are just a mess. They're cringe. They're all over the place. Johnny sounds like shit. I think Funny Man has a decent enough verse, but it's still nothing special. He still did this, does this. It's still the same thing he does every time. And I think the only part of this song that I've ever been like, oh, that sounds kind of nice, is the pre-chorus with Danny. Which immediately gets ruined, though, by the Danny and Funny Man chorus, where it just, it has the most obnoxiously annoying lines. The beat sounds awful. Like, I'm sorry. It does not work. I think that this song should have been left as an outtake. I'm sure there were other songs that they could have put on this album. This is one of the only Hollywood Undead songs ever that is always a skip, even when I'm at parties. I don't listen to this song. It just does not work to me. And once again, there's no such thing to me as a bad Hollywood Undead song or something that I would be like, "What? Don't put this on." If someone else put this on in the car, I'd probably just be like, oh, I don't really care for this song. But I wouldn't outright say that it's the worst song ever made. However, this is one of the few songs where I can agree with most people, where if someone tried to say, oh, I like Hollywood Undead, this is my favorite song by them, I would say, you have no taste. I don't think it should be in anybody's top 10 Hollywood Undead lists of any party songs, anything, not even top 10 in this album. It's very bottom of the barrel for their songs, in my opinion. Even some of the remixes that they've done were better than this. So, track 14, Delish. I made a really ironic comment in the original thing here. It says, the chorus of this song says that it's about to go down, but it's the last track on the unabridged album, at least this on CD, which just kind of, I know this is off topic, but looking in the CD, like in the booklet, the artwork that was done for this album is fantastic. It really is. I don't think there's any other albums that they've done that have actually hit that same. This is definitely their most artistically creative album, in my opinion. Like, the whole album all throughout has a very, it has a similar sound and theme, but it never sounds like each song is doing the same thing. They are able to do their own style that they were doing on, like, each song, you know, it has the vibes of their previous two albums. It feels like a natural progression, but it also feels like putting this album on from beginning to end feels like an experience. It feels like you're in my opinion, like a big creepy haunted house, and they're just playing these songs. And I really enjoy that. And I think that the artwork and everything all around this album really feels like an extension of that. Or like that you maybe found a possessed record. And which kind of is, I think, is like, if you look on the album cover, it looks like it's supposed to look worn down, but it never is. Like, even a new copy looks like it's supposed to be all ripped up and worn. So it very much feels like this is a haunted record that was never supposed to be heard, and I really enjoy that. It's like the Jumanji of rap rock.
I know that's being sidetracked, but
I do think that I actually enjoy this song more than No Other Place for like a Funny Man solo song. I think that this does what that song set out to do in a much better way. And despite the fact that it says it's about to go down and then ends the album with that, I think the end of it really like sets off the tone of the album. Like, you're not ending really sad, but you're not ending like wanting more. You're ending going, that's really funny. And it gets you a nice laugh at the end that you're not listening to this album and then at the end being like, what the fuck did I just listen to? I mean, you're saying that, but you're saying it laughing, right? They're not ending the album trying to act all tough and serious and epic. You're ending this album with them being like, literally saying, suck my dick if you don't like this song. Like, that's like the last thing they say. So it's just, it's very much of them being like, by the way, we're not planning to continue trying to be tough and edgy. This is just something we did for one thing. And you can feel that they're just joking around. They're still the same people from, you know, the MySpace days who were joking around. And it's not, they're not, they're just evolving their sound, but they're not planning to go in this serious, edgy direction of we need to be taken seriously. Which is some dramatic irony considering what will happen about 10 years from now.
Track 15, I Am.
I'm just going to straight up read what I wrote on the original script, because it just says Hollywood Undead featuring SpongeBob SquarePants, and I don't think there's more of an accurate description for this song. It's a bit of a mess. Johnny drops a homophobic slur in the first verse, which I never cared about, but the fact that they censored it shows that they didn't want to release it. So then why did they release it? J-Dog's verse is the same as ever. Charlie has a really good verse on this, and I enjoyed it, but the chorus just ruins the whole song, because yes, it literally sounds like SpongeBob, and I cannot take it seriously in any way. And this is another song like Dead by It, where they're or Kill Everyone, where they're trying to like prove that they're big tough guys, and you know, Charlie does it well, even J-Dog does it semi well, so, and Johnny does it pretty good despite the cutting out the slur to be tame. So the fact that Danny sounds like SpongeBob really just takes away from that, unfortunately.
Track 16, New Day.
This is something that I think shouldn't have actually been a bonus track. I don't know why that this was an iTunes exclusive or best. I think this was Best Buy exclusive, actually.
One of them was. I Am, I think, was Best Buy exclusive, and then this was iTunes exclusive, I believe, or it could be reverse.
I'm not entirely sure, but each one of these was only to a specific service or a specific way of buying the album. But this song shouldn't have been a bonus track. I think they should have replaced one of the tracks on the album with this. I think this could have been an album opener, an album closer, just a song on the album. Like, this needs to be heard by more people. I would put this above Rain in terms of how much I actually resonate with it. And I think they should have replaced Pigskin. That's my personal opinion. If they were going to replace any song on the album with this, it needed to either be in Pigskin or Kill Everyone. I think doing Rain, this, and then Rain, New Day, and then Believe would have been way too much emotional baggage in like in a row. So I think replacing Pigskin with this would have maybe done better. And maybe moving Rain up a few tracks, maybe putting Rain as track 3, Another Way Out, New Day, Kill Everyone. Like, I think kind of doing that. But it is really interesting. This is a really good track. And I genuinely think that this could be up there with my like top 3 of ballads of all time, honestly.
Like, if I had to make, like, a top 10 ballads in general, like, top 10 emotional rap songs or something, or, I would put this in my top 10 Hollywood Undead songs, which is why it's a shame that so little people have heard it. Track 18, Another Way Out, Griffin Boyce remix. I think that this
is better than the original. And there's a reason for it, because it suits the vibe that they wanted to go for without sounding silly. And I think that if they needed to include Another Way Out and they needed to make a song about what that song is about, that this would have been a much better way to do it. It feels very foreboding and menacing. It doesn't feel like it's mocking victims of SA. It more so feels like showing men how scary being followed by a predator could feel. And that alone makes this song better. This remix feel much more like what they wanted to do. Track 18, Another Way Out. All right, I did that one. I just screwed up. That's all good. Track 17, We Are, J-Dog and Killtron remix. This remix is better than some of the stuff from the Redux album, but it's not anything special, and I don't personally prefer it. It really lacks the heaviness that the original song actually has, so.
God bless America. Let's go.
Following it up on following it up, oh my gosh, why is this so hard? Following up on our review of Deuce's Nine Lives, I decided to give an update on what he was doing during this time. From 2013 until, well, we'll cover some more of it in the next episode of this, whenever that gets done. But Deuce would release several collaborations with other artists. I'm not doing these in any specific order. He did a few with Broken Side. He did a couple with Blood on the Dance Floor. They were dog shit because that band is awful and the artist should actually kill themselves. If you don't know, those guys are all every single member of that band are all convicted pedophiles. That's why their music isn't on Spotify or anything anymore, because like it got so bad that they were just removed. It's impossible to find their music now because of them all being outed as essentially a group of pedophiles coming together to make music meant for 12-year-old girls. Which is why it's unfortunate that, you know, I didn't even bother listening to the collaborations that they did with Deuce, because it's impossible to find them. Like, you have to go to some underground websites for this shit and get viruses on your computers. They used to have some of them on YouTube, but I think that after they got actually, like, found guilty, they were all deleted because I couldn't find them anymore, and I also didn't want to listen to them. So they also did a couple with Broken Side, you know, one of the biggest bands that was of the MySpace age. Deuce did a couple of them. He did Never Back Down, which I quite enjoyed, and there was, like, one other. I'm actually going to go re-listen to them now. It's been a long time since I've heard them and give my honest opinion. Also because I can't remember the other one.
I'm just writing from my experience and shit.
And Davis, who tries to rap and can't even sing. Spreading his rumors and filling up his beer gut with the last of his Coors.
Okay. Ready, my brother?
Over here.
Still walking it, still rocking it. It's Deuce, why you talking it?
Oh, that was special.
That's sick, dude. That's fucking dope.
That's good, dude. I think that sounds pretty good. I'll add more music.
Yes, so me view me as a villain, but treat me like a felon, like a weapon. My mind is like my senses, I know when they pretend shit. Acting like it's friendship, kiss my fucking necklace. And I show you a motherfucking witness. In every single line I spit, I spit like I'm too talking shit. Yeah, I'm still rocking it.
All right. right, giving an update on the Deuce collaborations now that I've re-listened to all of them. It had been so long since I'd even thought about them. So, Who Can Stop Us Now, which is a song by Ronnie Radke from his rap mixtape, Watch Me, which never actually got a full release. He only released like 9 out of 14 songs. Which is like, okay. But anyway, featuring B-Lay and Deuce on this song. It's called Who Can Stop Us Now. This was the song, I had never listened to Falling in Reverse. I had never heard of Ronnie Radke or any of this. Like, this was the song that I actually listened to because Deuce was on the chorus. And I do enjoy it, actually. Like, I'm not a fan of Ronnie Radke as a person. I can't sit here and say that I know everything. Like, I'm not going to go throw bullshit out about him because I've been in his shoes. I've been in situations like what he's been in. So I don't think he's a shit person. I don't think that he's all these things that people say. But at the end of the day, there are things he says and does that make him look bad that I can't say that I agree with or support or can excuse. So I'm not going to sit here and say that he's my favorite person in the world or that I enjoy him or even his music. A lot of FIR is just such a so bad it's good kind of thing. I think some of the recent stuff he's been doing I've been a fan of. I actually started really enjoying FIR around when they released they released Popular Monster. I got into that and I listened to them pretty like seriously into them until I saw them live with Hollywood Undead shortly after Watch the World Burn came out, and I still like Watch the World Burn. And I was actually like, okay, when are, and then I unironically enjoy the album that they did called Coming Home. Like, you can never make me not like that album, actually. But I can totally, like, I understand the criticisms. Coming Home is the only album by them I actually genuinely listen to, even after having reviewed it all. So I don't go slandering all his music, saying it's all shit just for the hell of it. I also listen to Dying Is Your Latest Fashion. It's really, he released the new song Ronnie. This was before he did All My Life. He did a Ronnie. I actually really liked that song, only to get to Tech9's verse and realize that it really killed that song. And then I didn't enjoy All My Life whatsoever. I thought it was actually garbage. So I think this new album he's doing is going to be a mixed bag. And when that does come out, I'm going to be re-ranking all the FIR albums, re-ranking all the ETF albums, and reviewing all the Dead Rabbit albums. Because I never actually covered Dead Rabbits when I did all of those reviews. But I'm interested in covering them now because I totally forgot they existed. And also ETF has released Out of the Shadows 2.0. So I'm definitely interested in giving... I was already wanting to do a re-review of every, or a re-ranking, like I did with Bon Jovi recently. And then they released Out of the Shadows 2.0. I started to work on my re-ranking. I got up to I think I got up to the self-titled ETF album, and then I moved, and so I've just been busy and haven't really been able to get to that. So in August, when the new FIR comes out, I'll probably just start doing all of that. And that's probably most likely when that's going to happen. I think that's pretty fair. I also, but yeah, I think Ronnie actually has some rapping chops in this song. It's one of the few times he raps where I'm like, okay, you know what? I can see why he wanted to do this. I can see why this wasn't just, oh, rap rock's big again, I'm going to do this. No, I can feel it when he's rapping in Who Can Stop Me Now or Who Can Stop Us Now, that this is something he's passionate about. It's just not something he's very good at, besides in this song. Deuce's chorus is great. The beat itself is pretty great. B-Lay's, you know, kind of mid, but that's only because I'm not the most well-versed rap person. That's why I'm not going through like analyzing if the bars were any good, because they really weren't. It's more so you can feel when Ronnie is rapping that he wants to be that fast Eminem like rap. And this is around the time Rap God had came out too. So you can tell he really like this was when everybody was trying to do fast rap because Eminem had done it on Rap God. So you could, it definitely feels dated. And the, like I said, the bars themselves aren't great, but I'm not a rap expert. So I'm not going to sit here and be like, this is a good or a bad song. I enjoy it for what it is, but I only enjoy the first like half of it. And it's only because Deuce is on it. So if you are a big fan of Deuce, go listen to it. If you're a big fan of Ronnie, sure. I mean, I'm not going to judge, but I don't know why you would be. But at the end of the day, if you're a rap listener, I don't think you'll get like, and you're hardcore into it, I don't think you'll get much enjoyment out of this, to be honest. But who knows? Because my stepdad's the one who got me to listen to this song, and he is a big like rap enjoyer. Like he listens to like everything. There's rappers that are so underground that, you know, you never would have guessed, but it. He got me to listen to this, so yeah, you know, there you go. Some, it's kind of not everyone's thing, but whatever. Like, yeah, my stepdad likes it, my dad doesn't. They both listen to a lot of rap, so that kind of gives you the idea of like some people will enjoy it, some people won't. It's really up to your own personal preference of what you like. So yeah, I personally enjoy the chorus and I enjoy parts of verse one, but I can admit that it's a flawed song, that really the main appeal to it for me is the chorus. The two Broken Side collaborations, actually before I do that, I found something new today. So it's a song called Jagger Swagger. It's by a band called Electric Callboy. They got big pretty recently, but they've been around since like 2010. I did not realize that Electric Callboy and Eskimo Callboy are the same band. I was into them when they were a big scene band known as Eskimo Callboy. So I did not realize that they were the same group, that they renamed themselves and have released a bunch of very different sounding stuff. They basically rebranded as a whole new band. They went from a scene metalcore band to kind of like one of those bands you put on as a joke because it's funny. I remember I was hanging out with my dad and my uncle one time. This was a long time ago. And my uncle had been like, have you heard of Electric Callboy? I'm like, I don't know. I've heard of Eskimo Callboy. And they thought it was different. And I thought it was a different band, but it sounded really similar. And sure enough, yeah, it's the same group. Just they basically reinvented themselves. But anyway, it's a song called Jagger Swagger from way back in their MySpace scene kid days. And Deuce features on the chorus, and then there's some German rapper also on it, which, so like first verse with all the screamo and stuff, it was really well done. I think it's my favorite Deuce collab, period. Deuce doesn't really do anything but the choruses on both Who Can Stop Us Now and this. I don't really know why, because he can rap. I don't know why they had this random German guy come in the second verse when Deuce would have rapped perfectly over a beat like that. I don't know if it was a decision on Deuce's part. I don't know if it's because they're a German band. Like, I don't know this. But the German part really does not flow or sound well. And it just kind of comes out of nowhere because the rest of the song is in perfect English. So I don't know why they did that. And then to jump in with Deuce on the chorus, I think this is Deuce's best chorus ever. Like, Hollywood Undead, his own stuff, everything. This chorus that he does, to me, shows that he has the talent of, he can sing. He's a singer. He can sing well. He just prefers to do the more hardcore, raspy vocals. But he has the ability to do the high-pitched kind of clean vocals that like Danny can do. He has a voice for it. He just doesn't like to do them. And they probably strain him because he has a very naturally nasally, lower pitched voice, kind of like me. His is more nasally than mine though, but it is very similar. And like for me, I can hit clean high pitched vocals. It's just hard for me to do it. It's a lot more strain than to do like a growly kind of thing. But anyway, I really enjoyed this collab. And then going on to the Broken Side collaborations, which are called Fuck That and Never Back Down. Fuck That was, it wasn't good. I liked Juice's verse. I think he actually rapped really well on it. But, oh no, wait. Yes, he did. He did. That one was really well done. But the rest of the song was just not my thing. And Never Back Down, which for some reason wasn't released on an album and was only released on their comp on Broken Side's 13-year compilation album, which is such a random thing to do. And it's track one, but it's a new track. I don't know. But I enjoy Never Back Down significantly more, but it's still very much sounds like, it kind of sounds like Fashionably Late. Like, it sounds like something Ronnie would have done during that era, which makes sense. It came out around that this came out the same year, and every like scene band was doing this sort of thing. Like, I know Attila was doing the same thing, but I think Attila is one of the few that actually did it well at the time, if I remember correctly. I haven't listened to them since Chaos came out in 2016, so it's been almost 10 years. And then I just remembered another collaboration that occurred in this era. Deuce was kind of just hopping all over the place from 2013 to 2016, which, yeah, some of these are not timed at the same time that Notes from the Underground was new. There's definitely ones that didn't happen. But, like I said, these came out after like Day of the Dead would have came out, but there's no other real place that I would have been able to talk about these. I couldn't fit them into the Day of the Dead script because that one's actually a lot longer than this one. I just think, yeah. So it's a song called The Last Time from Ashes to New, which is ironic that they did. This was on like, I believe their first or second album. And this is my favorite Deuce collaboration where he raps, because he doesn't sing on this one. He does a rap at the end and he kind of comes in as a guest rapper, and it is pretty cool. I remember the verse. I haven't heard it in since I was probably like 13, but it's like, quiet as a mouse, always shut in my mouth, quiet in the beginning till I figured it out. Look at me now, straight spitting without. All these fake ass motherfuckers holding me down. You thought I had a nervous breakdown, I was playing around. Your whole crew went underground soon as I dropped the fuck out. As soon as I stepped on the scene, start knocking him out, stomping him out, just for trying to block my ass out. What the fuck you talking about? Rocking the crowd. This is rock, not pop. Look who's popular now. Bitch, please stop talking me down. The only thing that you were ever good at was mocking me. How couldn't I see that you were stopping me? I think that's how it goes. This is like, I have K-Wing Let's Plays on my TV right now. I'm watching a live stream of Suicide Squad Kill the Justice League, so like, which I've never played, but it doesn't look horrible. I heard a lot of bad about it, but it doesn't look like it's the worst game ever. I think if they do what Avengers did and they make it like pretty much free, I mean K-Wing's playing it and talking shit about it, but it looks decent. It looks like the kind of game I would like. So anyway, because I liked the Avengers game, but yeah, I haven't heard the song in like 10 years, but I remember that verse being very catchy and I really enjoyed it. I mean, the fact I just remembered it from memory kind of shows you what I was thinking. Like I remember though, it was very fast. Like the whole, not Deuce's verse was like well flowed on the beat. Whereas the entirety of the rest of the song was the other guys like going as fast as they could. While also trying to sound like tough guy. And I don't know. It's just like, I don't know. But, it does. Yeah. I don't even know, man, but it is ironic because that same group, like 10 years later, oh no, it wouldn't be 10. It was only like 6 years later would do. Cause it was during like the New Empire release era that they did a collaboration with Johnny. So I find it really funny because they're like collecting that kind of thing. I think the Johnny collab was better personally. That's just my humble opinion, but I do really enjoy Deuce's verse on The Last Time. And then I think that's...
Deuce did a collab song with his sister called Will You Cry For Me. It's not my cup of tea, but it doesn't mean it's a bad song. I think his sister was trying to kind of go for a, like, not Taylor Swift. What's the, like, closest thing I could think of? It's very much just a piano ballad, and his sister didn't release anything after that song until, like, 2018. She released, like, an EP, and then she just kind of dropped off the face of the earth. I think she had a son and has been involved in a custody battle or something, and she just hasn't had anything to do with music because she doesn't care, which is fine. But this is the one song she actually collabed with her brother on. And for some reason, instead of having her brother do the verses and rap and then having her sing, she sings the verses and then he does the chorus. And I don't know. I just feel like that would have been better if they reversed it. They did almost like a Fort Minor or like a Love the Way You Lie kind of song, because it's clearly about her boyfriend at the time. So I don't know why they don't have Deuce do like a rap about, even if it was about HU, but framing it as like a relationship. Like, I think they could have had a really well done song like that, but they just never took that route with it. So it's just not my cup of tea, but it's a decent song. Like, it's in my playlist. I just don't listen to it often. Deuce would also, this is the best one he did in this era. He released a song called Just Pretend, which is hard to find, but it's actually one of my favorite Deuce songs, period. And it actually features his sister. It features Gadget and it features DJ Corbett. And I think all around it's a well done song. It's weird though, because you don't really hear his sister or DJ Corbett do anything. They do the chorus, but they do it together. So it's not like they get through, and then Deuce does two verses and then Gadget does the last verse, but all around, and he does the intro, like the spoken word intro. But I actually think it's a really well done song. I enjoy it quite a bit. I think there's a couple lines in it that are actually disses towards Shady Jeff of all people, because I guess people had been asking Jeff like, yo, what happened with you, Deuce, and Hollywood Undead or some shit. I don't know. But I guess Jeff posted a picture on Instagram with a gun, and Deuce is basically like, okay, and you already pointed your gun at me and I wasn't scared. Like, you lied about why you got kicked out of Hollywood Undead. Like, don't tempt me to post the truth kind of thing. And then this is kind of the most infamous situation with Deuce at the time, is Deuce got really sick of the label not wanting to release his stuff. He was working on his sophomore album titled Invincible, and he really wanted to release it, and they did not want him to release it. I don't know the details. I know that there was some legal battles involved. There was a whole bunch of stuff he got, and he ended up just posting it online for free. And it was, a lot of people really liked it. I remember my stepdad downloaded it. We listened to it together, and it was really well done. There were a couple songs on there that felt a little bit unpolished or like unfinished. Like, they were good, but they definitely sounded, you know, like they hadn't really been mixed perfectly, because he clearly leaked like a rough draft of the album for free. And so not really any of the songs actually survived. The label basically forced them all to be DMCA'd, and you can't really get the album anymore in the original way that it came out. About three of the songs, original versions, survived. But unfortunately, they're gone as well. They survived. They were circulating online for a while. There was one specific YouTube channel that posted them and kept them up there. But about, I want to say it was 2022, that channel got terminated. So now those demos don't exist. But if I remember correctly, it was a demo for the title track. It was a demo for Bad Attitude. And it was a demo for My Buddy, or something like that. Or it might have been titled, it was like four, it was like an EP's worth of demos. Like, it was like five or six songs, I believe. And it was like Bad Attitude, My Buddy, Invincible, Thank You, Nightmare, and like one other song that I think it was Bleed or something. But yeah, there was a bunch of different songs that Got those versions still. I think only three of them actually stayed circulating around, but I can't remember which ones it was. I believe it was Thank You, Invincible, and My Buddy stayed circulating. And then there was a couple copies of Bad Attitude, but they got deleted before any of the others. But unfortunately, I'm unable to re-listen to those demos. I don't have a copy of them anymore, as unfortunate as that is. I used to have a copy on my laptop of those demos. I used to have a copy of those demos, but my laptop got stolen and wiped, and now I have it back, and it doesn't have those demos on it. So, and I didn't upload it to the cloud or anything, because I'm dumb, I guess. But, yeah. And then Funny Man, J-Dog released a couple collaborations, like he collaborated with some other people. It was a song called Countdown. There was like one other. I believe I could be wrong about when this released. I don't know if it was here or if it was after Day of the Dead. But there was a song by an artist called Oh Ye Rabble Rouser, which is a really weird name. And never released another song after this song. And it was called Freak Nasty. And it had Johnny Three Tears featuring. And it was like a... There was a bunch of different things like that, though. Where it was like a bunch of the Hollywood Undead members would separately show up on an album or on a song that was collaborating with an unknown artist who never released a song again. There was about six of these. There was two with J-Dog. There was one with Johnny. There was one with Funny Man. And then there was one with Charlie and one with Danny or something like that. And a lot of people were like, what the fuck? Like, this is weird. Like, I could probably find them right now. I might pause the time to listen, take the time to listen to them real quick. I'm not sure. I can search them. I can see. I think, I don't know if all of them are on here. One of them was called Chicken Coop. I'm just searching on Spotify as I'm on here. Yes. Chicken Coop, which I will just add to my overall playlist, because why the fuck not? It's by an artist called Loki and featuring Gwen Payne and J-Dog. I think that one was a genuine one. Okay, let's try. Well, I mean, you can't find the song called Freak Nasty if it's not by Megan the Stallion anymore. But there was one that featured Johnny. I can't see it anymore, unfortunately. But a lot of people would take some of these songs and man, I don't know, man. I don't know. I can't find any of them. I could probably... Oh, I don't have Reddit on my phone anymore. Because I had a post saved on Reddit that was every collaboration or song outside of just Hollywood Undead that each member had done. But I can't. I can Google it, I guess. I'm sorry. This is going to be really long. I mean, I'm just realizing that this is going to be really long. And I might end up having to need to record, like, screen-captured gameplay to cover that up for footage. Labs. All right, so I'm on the fandom page. So let's see here. Yeah, so Chicken Coop. Countdown by Monster Squad. I can search that one up because, like, I'm trying to just see, like, no, one sec. Mm-hmm.
This is weird. Why are there three artists named this exact same thing with none of them having any songs? That's kind of what I'm saying, though, is they keep showing up like this. This one's another J-Dog one, by the way. I could search J-Dog and see if there's like an artist that accidentally got tagged with these or something, but I'm not sure. No. That's really weird. I know that J-Dog himself has a SoundCloud, but none of this is what's on there. This one came out... Okay, so Countdown came out in 2012, so shortly before Notes from the Underground came out. So that's fine. I guess Chicken Coop came out in 2018, which I didn't know about. So that came out like way, way after this. This would have came out probably between Psalms EP and New Empire Volume 1. Here's Freak Nasty. This one has some theories about it, which is why I'm interested here. Because it sounds like a Hollywood Undead song. There's nobody who actually seems to know who this artist is. He doesn't seem to exist. And his voice has like 20 filters on it at a time. And so a lot of people have basically taken apart the vocals and fiddled them. And it until it came out, like that OE Rabble Rouser is just... It just was Danny and Charlie overlapping the same vocals and then mixing their voices together. And then there's another one from 2016, Never Look Back, which was supposed to have Charlie doing vocals. It's by, Three Pill Morning, but he wasn't able to, the label wouldn't let them do the lyrics, wouldn't let him do it. Yeah, and it was never actually released. Okay, so it was never actually released, I see. So I guess he did the vocals, they wanted to release it, the label said no. I don't know why, but they didn't. So, and then it's also, I'll be covering that one next episode, that's why I can't talk about that here. Because I'm planning to do that. Next, there's 11 collabs in one, like, go around. That's why I'm like, I'm gonna wait for that. And then there was two more that came out around this time. 2013, Pussy Weed and Butthole by a group called Bastard Wax Crew, which just has Killtron and Funny Man. And it's just really cringe. Like, some of these lines are really dumb. Like, just the dankest of the spankiest of weed. I'm sniffing up that ass. She's riding my mustache. Like, these are just actual lines that they're in this line. Had pussy for lunch, so your butthole for dinner. Butthole so nice, had to lick it twice. Butthole should run for office. Like,
This is the one of the few ones that's actually kind of clever. My chain took a shit, now I got two chains. No, I'm not talking about the rapper. We're talking about my bling. Like, it's kind of dumb, but it's kind of, like, that one's kind of, I feel like Marshall would have liked that one. And then there's The Only Ones, which is interesting because it was a song written by Deuce for Hollywood Undead's American Tragedy. This kind of confirms, more or less, that Deuce was supposed to be there during the writing process of American Tragedy, that the album was significantly altered from what it was meant to be. So this song is a song called The Only Ones. In fact, during Deuce's Story of a Snitch, when he released that online, there was a clip of this song, because this was supposed to be a song released on what would eventually turn into I'm sure it would have had a different name. But that this song, Tear It Up, El Urgencia, and Dove and Grenade, they were all supposed to go on this eventual second album. Deuce was already kind of being kicked out of the band around the time that Desperate Measures was dropped, which was a live DVD, which is why there's a bunch, he's not on that album. He's only on two songs, period, of that album, because he was already out of the band. He took that album cover with the American flag in the background. That was American Tragedy's original album cover with Deuce in the band. They were writing those songs for American Tragedy. It was going to be called American Tragedy. They had it all planned out in terms of, like, they were going to keep going with him in the band. Obviously, there's been other artists, like other members in the band, who said that that album probably never would have came out if Deuce remained in the band. I think it would have. I think it wouldn't have come out as fast as it did. And I think that was their biggest problem, was they wanted to rush more stuff out because the label wanted them to. And Deuce was more content with taking 2 to 3 years to make an album, as he has proven time and time again. With the fact that he released his first album in 2012, and then it took him till 2015 to drop anything new, and then took him till 2018 to drop. He's been more than willing to take the time to wait, whereas HU hasn't. And he also doesn't like to do the extensive touring, and his way of working and their way of working were very different, but I really do think that it was a general thing where he was unwilling to compromise, they were unwilling to compromise. Maybe there was probably some egos involved because they were starting to get big, and I feel like he was kicked out, but he also didn't really care enough to fight it, and egos just kind of clashed, and it really was just creative differences. But yes, The Only Ones was written for what would become American Tragedy. And after everything happened with Deuce, he took that song with him. Originally he didn't have it. He sued Hollywood Undead. He won the lawsuit, which is how Nine Lives was able to be released, because he wasn't allowed to release anything under the name Deuce, as that name was supposedly copyrighted under the Hollywood Undead and under the Interscope label. Then Deuce said, go fuck yourself. He sued. He said, well, I created that name, so I should be allowed to use it. The name The Producer is copyrighted under Hollywood Undead. Deuce was a short form for that. But if I just use Deuce and not The Producer, I'm allowed. And he won. And so this song was something he intended to release, but then basically Johnny and Deuce, it was going to be, from what I've understood, a Johnny Three Tears and Deuce song, kind of in the vein of like Paradise Lost. And Johnny just gave it to a band at the time known as Mest. I think that they still go by Mest because Ice Nine Kills released a song with one of the members of Mest. But they gave it, and Deuce had not released it himself yet. Mess released it under a song called Kisses for, under an band called Kisses for Kings, that was released in a EP called Forget to Remember in 2010. And Johnny basically, he covered his verse. I'm sure there were other members, but Johnny actually did his same verse that he was supposed to do on that album. And this released in 2010, like I said. So this came out even before American Tragedy came out. At the end, like it says, at the end of Story of a Snitch, there's a snippet of the original version of the song. And meanwhile, when he released that snippet of his original chorus for that song, this version was already released. So, and he mentions that too. He's like, you gave the song I wrote for you to Mest. So it's clear that he only posted that to prove that it was his song originally and that they fucked him over for that, which was really shitty on their parts, but I get it. Like, it was he never released it. And I think we've got everything covered that we wanted to talk about here in this episode. This has probably been a long one just because there was a lot of improv and a lot of talking and discussion, but I'm glad to do this because it's been a long time since I've actually made a video like this. So I hope that you guys enjoyed, and I don't know when I'll be doing the Day of the Dead episode. That one's going to be even longer than this because I'm not just covering Day of the Dead. I'm also covering I'm covering an album by Attila that was a joint collaboration with Hollywood Undead. So yeah.